Hey everybody, and welcome to the shop, or should I say we're down in the dungeon today, or even better, we are down in the dungeon lumber yard, because we are continuing on our lumber series, what you do in a lumber yard. This is series two. In the first video, we talked about measuring a board foot, measuring the thickness of a lumber using the quarters system. We talked about figure and how that affects the cost of lumber, which it can drastically do. And we also talked about grading lumber, FAS, common, and so forth. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about what's going on in the lumber yard. Before I get to that, I want to talk about, and I don't want to go real political here, but I do think it's worthwhile to talk a little bit about what's going on in the world. We are fighting this coronavirus thing right now. And all I want to say is I hope everybody out there is safe. You know, YouTube is basically a worldwide entity here, and you know, some of us in certain countries are taking a pretty hard hit. I just want you to know we're all thinking about you. You know, it's coming here to the United States now. We are about to go through what you went through. I just hope everybody's safe. Please adhere to what your governments are telling you to do, and we'll get through this. Enough politics for me, to be honest with you. Let's get back to woodworking. So a few things that you need to know as you're driving to the lumberyard. You know about the four things we talked about in the first video. When you get to the lumberyard, a little common sense has to prevail here. Please leave the bin that you go to like you found it. You know, so if you have to move five or six boards to get the board you need, put them back. Common sense, you know, just deal with that. Also, some lumberyards allow you to use a block plane and scrub a little bit of lumber off just to see, you know, the color, the grain pattern. Ask. If they say you can do that, go ahead and do it. It's fine. Another very important thing to think about is the equipment you own currently, your tooling. You know, at a lumber yard, lumber comes in many, widths. If you only have a 6-inch joiner like I do, those 13-inch boards are either going to be ripped down to put on your joiner, or you're going to finish it with a hand planes. And hey, if you're doing hand tool work for this, great, go ahead and do it. Other than that, you might want to look at thinner, narrower boards. And that brings me to the last thing I want to talk about before we pull a board out, is start at the common bin. Most furniture can be built from common lumber. You remember from our talk last week, the common grade of lumber doesn't have to be as long as the FAS lumber, and it doesn't have to be as wide. As you can see, I got a stack back here. I'm going to build this entire table out of common build lumber. As you're beginning with woodworking, common lumber is the way to go. As you progress, maybe you're going to advance to where you're looking for some figure, and you're going down to the other end, and you're getting some more expensive lumber. For now, for this table, we're going to build this table out of common lumber. I'm going to have a cut list for you. I will also do a SketchUp drawing for this table that we're going to build. I'm learning SketchUp now, so it's not ready yet, but I hope to have it ready before the table build is done. So let's get a board out here and let's start doing it. Hey everybody, alright, so I rearranged the camera a little bit and we now have a board here on the table saw. A couple of things to note here, I just randomly grabbed one from the front of the stack that looked about the right width for me. Obviously, you're going to have your cutlass with you, and I have one here. Like I said, I'm going to put this up so you can see it. And I'll make it available to download if you really want to see what it looks like. What we need is 8 pieces at 29 by 2 inches for the legs, 2 long aprons at 34 and a half by 3 inches, 2 short aprons at 3 inches by 14 and a half, and a top that's going to end up being 18 inches by 40 inches, which means for me 3 pieces at about 6 inches to make the 18 inches. The reason I grabbed this board is it is a little over 7 inches, close to 8 inches wide. Actually, it is just at 7 inches wide, and it is 7'1", so it's just over 7 feet. So we know from that it doesn't make the FAS grade because it's not 8 feet long. It is wide enough, but it's not 8 feet long. Now let's look at the faces. This is the better face by far. There's obviously a problem here. There's a piece missing here, an old knot. What I would start doing with this, if I was going to use this side, is start circling these problems. We have sapwood here. I don't like using sapwood on cherry. There's sapwood here. There's that knot here, and there's a problem here and a knot here. So this board, this is common. This is close to common. There's another problem here. This literally would be common, common grade 3 at, you know, just 33% clean face. You know, there's a piece here we could use, and there's a piece here we could use. If we were using this side of the board, we could get our two short aprons out of here. Now, this is too much, but this is at, you know, from there. This is a bad board on this side. But this side is perfectly clean. So what you have to be careful with is to make sure that the defects on one side don't come through to the other. The sapwood, we know, does not. You know, we can see that the sapwood does not come through. So this side of this board, I'm considering very usable. And I think what I can do is get one of my tops out of this board. So what I'm going to do next is look at the bottom, and I'm going to look at the top. Basically, the two ends. And I'm going to look for a check. Now, we have a knot here. So I'm going to burn about 4 inches here, because I don't know what that knot's doing. Normally, I burn 2 inches on the end of a board. I'm going to clip a video in here right now to show you why I do that and what I do with it. It's to find small cracks, small checks, they call them, that you don't see. And I'll show you how to check for those right now. Hey everybody, so this is a quick little demonstration on what I do at both ends of the board where I check for the checks. As you can see, I've marked a obvious visible check on the end of this little cutoff that I made here. This is just a cutoff for demonstration purposes. So what I'm going to do is, even though I know there's about a 4 inch long check there, I'm going to show you what I do normally, which is to take about 3/4 inch off of the area where I've marked off 2 inches, which is 2 inches what I normally mark off each end of the board where I say burning the board. And as you can see, this board has many cracks in it that are fragile and easy to break. So normally what I would do is go up another 3/4 inch and make another cut. And give it another test. And here we can see, if I smash it against the table, it easily breaks in the one spot where we still physically see the check. But the other areas seem to have firmed up. So if I just needed a narrow piece of this board, you know, above the crayon mark there, I could start using this board and rip the board to that piece. Because I want to use the full width of the board, we got to keep going. What I'm doing now is because I know I have a physical check that I can see, I'm going to go to the end of what I can see and cut all of that off, which is what I'm doing right here. Okay, and as I cut these two pieces off, I don't get anything to break off. So I am deeming that board, which is only 2 inches, but the rest of it to be good now if it was an 8 foot long board. So I'm gonna make another cut here on the piece that I can see the visible check, just to see how bad it was. And as we can see here, it seems pretty solid now. I can't break it. Although I'm going to show you here in a second that I still can see a visible crack at this end that doesn't go all the way through anymore. So I'm still glad that I wasted a couple more inches. Okay, now we're back and we have the board. We figured out that we have a good clean face here. What I'm going to do is, because I know I want my top to be 40 inches, I know I burned 2 inches there, I'm going to measure 44 inches. Make a mark. And I'm just going to draw, I'm not even trying to make this line square or anything, because I am burning 2 inches extra here. I have, That does not look right. Yeah, it says it's 44 inches. So we're going to call this top one. Now what I'm doing here, writing on this board, I'm doing this because I've made the decision I'm going to buy this board. I wouldn't recommend writing on lumber until you've made that choice. Let's be honest, you know, this crayon's not going to affect anything. If you do make a mistake and put a board back with a little bit of crayon on there, it's not going to be the end of the world. Now I want to talk to you about a couple of different ideas about what you do with lumber. And I've made up names for both of these. I call one side of the spectrum the IKEA way of picking lumber. And the other side of the spectrum I call the David Marks idea of picking lumber. And I am not picking on David Marks. I think he's a master wizard at furniture making as well as wood turning. I mean, he's an artist is what he is. David's an artist that actually has a master craftsman as well. But there's two different ways to do picking lumber. The first way would be the IKEA way, which you basically then, all right, I have my line here, now I need another piece. What do I have left? You know, I have 36 inches here, and I know I need two long aprons at 34 and a half inches, so I could, in essence, take a line right here, right down the middle, and say long apron one and long apron two. Nothing left there, nothing left there. So I've made as much use of this board as I can. And for this board, the grain is pretty straight. There's no defects here at all. I could probably get away with using exactly what I said here, because I have 3/4 of an inch to burn, and that's not going to work. So what we're going to do is we're going to say leg one here. I know I have 2 inches here and 3 inches here. So you got to kind of pick and choose from what you have in the board. So what I've done, what I'll do now is I'll say I have one piece for my top, I have one piece for my leg, and I have one piece for my long apron. And then we'll measure the board. It is, like I said, it's 7 by 7. That's 49 inches, 12 into 49. It's 4/4, so we're just dividing by, there's no sense dividing it again by one. This is basically a 4 board foot board. You know, 12, 24, 36, 48 would be 4 board foot and then a 0.1. So let's just say this is 4 board foot. So this is a $10 board. And I just write that on there, and then I will take it and I'll put it aside. And I'll grab my next board. All right, guys, I got another board on the table here. This board's a real piece of, you got to just draw that off. That's gone. The rest of this board is good here. This is a very interesting, it would have been a knot. There was a limb here at one point. It's got an interesting grain pattern to it. It's even more interesting on this side. Obviously, we're dead there. And this board has nothing for me here. There's really nothing I can do there. It's a beautiful piece of wood, but it's just a cutoff. There's nothing I can do with it on this end. So literally what I have here is, and now I'm trying to explain you the David Marks theory. I kind of did the IKEA theory where you get every inch of the board you can. I really think IKEA, when they're done with the board, all that's left is something about the size of a toothpick. And I think they put that in a box and sell it as toothpicks. I mean, they really do. I mean, that's one of the things they're good at, is they get every piece of, every square centimeter of the board they get. Where I joke about the David Marks thing is, you know, David, like I said, is truly an artist. And he might look at this board and say, all right, this board's a piece of garbage. But I like this right here. And he might say, I want this to be one of my aprons. And there's definitely plenty of room here for this to be Yeah, a front or a back apron, or a side apron, or basically, you know what I think? What I'm going to say is we're going to get both. We're going to burn 2 inches here like we did before. And we need 14 and a half, so 29 inches. We have 50 inches. So out of this 50 inches, I don't have enough to put them both side by side here. David would look at this and say, I think this grain pattern here looks good. So I'm just going to use this piece right here and call it a short apron. And he'd get rid of the rest of the board, you know, because he's looking for color, he's looking for grain, he's looking to make a piece of art. The IKEA guy is going to keep building off here. I think we should all be somewhere in the middle. Obviously, we're not going to use crap like this unless, I don't know if you can see that, you know, unless you're one of those guys doing the new fill it with resin stuff, which I've never messed with. I'm going to look at this a little differently and say, I can get that short piece. I do like that piece of grain there. And I'm going to look at this board here now and say, I can get leg 2 and leg 3. Forget about that curve I drew there. This crayon is just rough markings. I will measure and cut these out properly when I do the rough cutting. So now I'm going to look at my board. And I'm going to drop my pencil, of course. So I'm going to look at my cut list again, and I'm going to say I got a short apron now. I got one of those, and I've got 2 more legs. I've got 5 more legs to go, a short apron, a long apron, and 2 more top pieces. So I'm going to go through the rest of this, and I'm going to pick all of my lumber out, and then I'm going to come back, and we're going to talk a little bit more. Okay, this board has an obvious check on the end. I'm sure the camera is not picking that up, but there is a check right here that goes about that far. Then there's a horrible knot right here that's loose. I don't know if you can see that. I can pop that knot out. So to me, this board is dead to there. And then it has this. This is a board that I would put back on the pile. So I wanted to show you an example of a board that has all of the problems. I don't think you're going to be able to pick up this check that I circled here, but I'm going to try to bring it around. I think you can pick up the knots. This one goes back in the pile, guys. You don't buy this board. All right, guys. I have now picked out 6 boards. I've got my whole cut list picked out. It's the same process over and over. I didn't want to show you all 6 of them. It would make this video too long. It's the same process. You check the ends. You check for straightness. You pick and choose where you think your parts go, and you draw them out with a crayon. I like doing the crayon options. Not everybody does that. You know, some guys can just look at the boards and say, okay, I'm good. Some guys can just factor in the board foot they need and, you know, just buy it and figure it out when they get home. I like to do the crayon method. I know I'm coming home with what I need. Now, let's talk a little bit about what you need. What I call the oopsie factor. Let's be honest, we all make mistakes. And some of these boards, you can see this is common lumber. There are defects in there that may, when you plane it down, show up that you didn't see, you know, when you purchased the board. So you need to purchase a little bit more lumber than your cut list says. And there's no rhyme or reason, there's no proper math on it. Some people say 20%, I've seen as high as 50%. The 50% number, I think, is more towards species of lumber that has more defects than average. There are certain species that have a lot of limbs, so a lot of defects. For me, I have an hour and 20 minute drive to get to my lumber yard. So I'm going to buy closer to that 35-40% extra. A table like this, I have 6 boards picked out. I'm going to bump that up to 8 boards. I'll probably buy 2 more of those 6.5 to 7 inch wide, excuse me, by 7 foot long, $10 board. So I'm going to spend an extra $20. If you live right around the corner from a lumberyard, you're lucky and you may not have to do this because you can always run right back and get one. This is one of those, you guys can make the call. Just realize that everybody makes a mistake cutting a board, and That infamous board stretcher tool hasn't been made yet. Once you cut it too short, it's too damn short. It is what it is. So there's not much you can do but grab another piece of lumber and keep going. So you want to have a few extra pieces on hand. If you nail it, you know, like I said, this is only 6 boards to make this project. So if I cut it right, I could get lucky and have a couple extra boards for another project. You know, I could make a nice jewelry box or something out of those 2 boards. You know, it's $20 I spent. I didn't need to. But trust me, my time driving 1 hour and 20 minutes each way and the gas is way more than $20 if I had to go back. You know, if you're working with oak or maple or poplar or pine, maybe you roll the dice and not buy that much extra because you know your home center stocked that lumber. You're paying a premium in the home center, but it could be a good insurance policy for you. If you're using, you know, cherry, walnut, and exotic, you know, and exotics, again, are expensive, so you gotta watch how much extra you spend because, one, it's lumber you're not gonna use that often, and two, you're gonna spend a lot of money on extra lumber if you don't use it, so you really wanna be on the ball there with your measurements and all of that. I use cherry all the time, so I don't mind grabbing a couple extra boards of cherry. Now, granted, I don't have to buy a couple extra boards because we are in Dungeon Lumberyard here, and I have a whole bunch over there. But, you know, if you're going to the lumberyard, those are some of the things you need to think about. And I hope this was informative to you. I hope it made sense. When I edit this, I might come back and do some more filming if it didn't make sense to me. Please put questions and comments down below if something doesn't make sense, because I don't want to mislead you and get you in the lumberyard and get you confused. So if I said something that didn't quite make sense or I didn't explain it enough, please ask the question. I'll either answer you in the comments. Well, I'll definitely answer you in the comments, but I may use that question in one of the, you know, beginning of the month sessions as well. My little talking head things where I talk about the next month. So that was the two-part series on what to do in a lumberyard. I hope, like I said, you enjoyed this. If you liked it, go ahead and hit that like button. If you haven't subscribed yet, please subscribe. Those two things really do help me, you know. Like I said, I'm trying to build this channel up, and likes and subscribes help the channel. It gets the algorithms working in the big YouTube centers, and somehow more people will see my videos if you guys hit that like button. So I totally appreciate it. Thanks again. Have a great day.